Bunbury Episode 10, Sinners and Saints, written by Helena Marchmont, narrated by Nathaniel Parker.
The only difference between the saint and the sinner is that every saint has a past and every sinner has a future. Oscar Wilde. Prologue. The tall, silver-haired man knelt down by the side of the track and carefully reorganized his backpack to make sure nothing would get broken. He glanced round at the farm shop. The woman who had served him had disappeared, and there was no sign of her coming back. The stocky, ruddy-faced man who ran to fetch her was probably her husband. It must have been some sort of emergency. She had rushed out of the shop after him, her apron flapping, and they both dashed off in the direction of the farm. She hadn't even paused to close the shop door, let alone lock it. The silver-haired man smiled. Perhaps she had been careless in her haste. But it was more likely that the need to lock the door hadn't crossed her mind. He could tell she wasn't the sort of woman to harbour suspicions about a stranger, however unusual their appearance. He at least had made sure to close the door. He refastened the backpack and hoisted it onto his shoulders. There was nobody else around, and from here he couldn't see the neighbouring farms, just fields and hills. It was a beautiful day, sunny, with a light breeze preventing it from getting too hot. As he set out for Bunbury, he began to sing. Chapter 1. The Policeman and the Vicar. Sergeant Harold Wilson was enjoying a convivial evening with his cronies in the Drunken Horse Inn. By the time his third pint arrived, he was telling them about his brilliance in solving a case involving a miscarriage of justice. Edith, the elderly mother of the horse's landlord, overheard him as she cleared a nearby table.
"Is that you taking credit where none is due, Harry?" she called. "That case was solved by the Bunbury Triangle, and well you know it."
"Women's seed oil," muttered Wilson, sufficiently quietly for Edith not to hear. "Scarcely knows what day it is. The Bunbury Triangle. They couldn't solve the Bugle's easy crossword. Idiotic name for a bunch of idiots. Two interfering old busybodies and a posh get from London."
"Interfering old busybodies? I'd like to hear you say that in front of Liz and Marge," said Steve Turner.
"He wouldn't dare," said Dan Bryan, laughing. "They might hit him with their handbags."
Sergeant Wilson, who had already been on the wrong side of Marge Redwood's handbag, gave a disparaging snort and returned to his pint.
"You've got to hand it to the Bunbury Triangle, though," said Jerry Metcalf. "They've got a pretty good track record in solving crimes around here."
Spluttering, Wilson turned on Jerry.
You're joking. You actually believe all that fake news? Crimes get solved by good old-fashioned police work, not three amateurs completely out of their depth.
Stung by this disloyalty from his so-called friends, he gulped down the rest of his pint and announced he was going home, even though it was his round. He was still in a foul mood the next morning, and it didn't improve when he turned up at the police station to find Constable Emma Hollis wasn't there. He belatedly remembered she was off on some training course at headquarters. He would have to make his own coffee.
"Training course is a load of rubbish," he muttered as he switched on the kettle. "You learn by doing."
His mood deteriorated further when he found the milk in the fridge had gone off, and he would have to drink his coffee black. There was still half a packet of chocolate digestives in the cupboard. Wilson dunked one in his mug in a bid to make the coffee more palatable. It helped, so he dunked another and settled down to read the sports pages. The computer suddenly bleeped. He didn't like the computer. You could press a key, and next thing you know...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.